Hey, look. It's car dealership tube man.
Hey. You be quiet there, you punk. Me? No. The ad on my Twitch channel. Stupid ads. God. It's like, this stuff should be free, dude. Business. What the hell's that about, right?
God damn it.
I thought we have DVR, right? That's why we can get rid of commercials, right? We can't DVR live Twitch streams.
Can you?
I don't know, man. We should probably look into DVR for Twitch streams so that we don't have to watch the ads in the beginning. What's up, everybody? All right. So we are live. Welcome, everybody. This is the Justin. Is it Goby or Goby?
Goby.
I don't know, man. I guess that would be like Gobby, right? Goby.
Yeah.
The Goby himself.
Technically.
Right. Yeah.
Very technical in the show.
Very serious. Very business oriented.
Yes.
No messing around, Justin. Okay. This is all business.
My bad.
All right, everybody. Hey, so I got Justin Goby Fields, the Goby himself, hanging out, and we're going to be doing some. Well, I not we really. It's Justin going to be doing some character concepting in ZBrush. So he's going to show us all of the magics in ZBrush.
Many magics.
All of the magics, in yes. His lime green, Nike flavored. CrossFit having ZBrush display that you guys get to see here in a second or two.
Oh my goodness. Already.
It's going to be a couple hours of just having fun. So, we're going to wait probably about 5 minutes and then we're going to tune into Justin's studio. And we'll see him start to do some stiff. Marcelo is my Rudy Tootie, Down and Fruity, awesome moderator that is here with us. Marcelo, I just made that up. So if you want to use that, you're more than welcome to. So.
Thanks, bro.
Yeah, really. Rowdy, I don't even know what he said. we do have some, if you guys have questions, we're going to filter those questions to a Google form that we have set up in chat here. So, if you have a question and you don't have a link to the Google form, just type in, into the chat, exclamation point questions, and, then you'll get the form, and then, we will collect, the questions that way. Unfortunately, Marcelo, I was going to have Marcelo on the chat with us today, but for some reason he couldn't make it. So let's all give him tons of crap for it, because that was definitely his one chance, and he totally missed it. Just joking.
Don't rub it in.
No. So he's unfortunately he couldn't be here in voice, but he will be here in chat. So. Marcel will definitely be helping us. Marcel will definitely be helping us to kind of get the questions filtered through all of the fun chat that we're gonna have. So, what's up, everybody? Okay. Probably about maybe a couple more minutes, and then we'll shoot it over to you. All right, Justin. What's going on, buddy?
Just getting ready here.
It's okay,
I'm
man.
Tying my brushes.
Do you have all the magic brushes?
I have all of them. I have the stuff that's like make it cool buttons. I have no, I'm just kidding. I do not. I wish.
Wait, there's no like make super badass awesome alien brush?
No, there isn't, actually. Believe it or not.
What is this, dude? I thought you were showing us all the magics.
Oh, well, I guess that's just.
I guess we'll just have to do it the hard way.
Gotta do it the hard way. Well, I can't just make magic happen. I'm not Harry Potter, okay?
Ah, man, do you have your wand today, huh?
Yeah, I'm just a muggle. And a wand's full of wizards.
That's awesome, dude. Well, you make it look easy. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, it was fun. It was fun. It was good seeing you at GDC, sir.
Yeah, dude, GDC was so awesome, man. So good. So you were at the you were doing some demos at the Wacom booth, right?
Yes, I was.
How was that?
Yes, I was. It was great. It was great. Had a good time. Got to do the VR experiences. That was really fun.
Which ones did you do?
I did the Himalayas one and the Star Wars one, the Trials of Tatooine.
Oh, what hardware though?
Oh, I think that's the HTC one, the Vive.
HTC. Oh, yeah, the Vive.
Vive.
Yes. Was that the only one that you got to do?
Yeah, I mean, we have an Oculus here in the office, but I mean, other than
that. Oh my God, I feel so bad for you. Really? my heart just breaks, man. How do you go to work every day? That would be so much torture.
It's terrible. It's awful. I mean, you have to play with toys all day, draw stuff, sculpt things. It's an awful job.
Yeah, right.
Terrible.
Oh man, that's awesome. Yeah, so hey Marcelo, just real quick, can you throw a link to the ArtStation challenge? Just to get people a little bit of a heads up on some of the stuff we'll be talking about. Oh, look, you already did it. Ha! Never mind. Bjorn's here. Bjorn, what's up, buddy? Bjorn Hury.
Oh, snap.
Dude, Bjorn's here. You know,
Bjorn.
You know it's real now.
I know, dude. Bjorn, I'm ready to have a few beers in Croatia again.
Oh, that'd be so much awesome. All right, dude, I'm going to turn your screen on. Hey, screen, how you doing? Not like that. Okay. All right. Now, you, sir, you have the reins.
Oh, are you sure about this?
No. Wait a minute. Hold on. Okay. Yeah. No, I'm sure.
All right. Well, I'm just gonna get started. I'm just gonna do a quick little bus robot thing here.
Robot. All right. So you're gonna do a little bit of organic and hard surface.
Yeah, just try to mix it up just a little bit.
Okay. Bjorn says, my body is ready.
Ooh.
Apparently the screen turn-on worked.
Mm-hmm.
What's up, everybody else? Ladies, how you doing? Guy Zero Design. There's all kinds of people here. Hey, how's everybody doing? Awesome. All right.
Hello, everybody.
So, let me just pull up my notes right quick. Okay, so you want to give us just a little bit of a lowdown of what you're going to be doing and what you're doing now and what your plan is here?
So yeah, usually when it comes to like blue sky type stuff where I'm just kind of winging it, you know, where I don't really have much of a brief, mm-hmm. I kind of just kind of pick out some references on the side. Or I just, you know, come out with just a quick sketch in my head. Normally, I definitely take the time to put together like a reference board and to figure that kind of stuff out.
Right.
But in a 2-hour time slot, you know, like it's kind of hard to show the full process.
Right. But, well, I mean, you can't create all those amazing, awesome things just in 2 hours.
You can, maybe. I don't know if you get lucky and they like your stuff.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go. So, let's say if you're doing something for, like actual studio, like the actual work, mm-hmm. What kind of time frame do you usually allot yourself for creating, a finished design?
Well, you know, honestly, the real goal, like, I guess, when you work with certain clients, you can tell the ones that have worked with professionals before where they will literally give you the time to do something proper and well thought out. Mm-hmm. However, unfortunately in Hollywood, as most of the movies you've probably seen can is it's most of the time it's rushed and it's the absolute wrong time to rush something.
Right.
Especially early on because it's determining what you're going to make stuff with, how it's going to look like, all that kind of stuff. So it's just like, it's one of those things where I truly and you know, honestly believe that less money on the back end, more money up front when you're developing a I guess, a major motion picture is the way I see it going. Especially when tools are getting simpler and easier to use. There's no reason not to do that kind of work in the beginning.
Gotcha. So, why ZBrush over other similar softwares?
Honestly, it's just super artist friendly, you know? When I went to Noman, I was lucky enough to take a actual, like, traditional sculpting class, like, right before I jumped into playing with ZBrush. And I definitely think that helped, you know, plus learning from people like Jared Krabesky, and, you know, Jared Moran's was definitely a bonus in my learning. Essentially, I got to play with ZBrush for 8+ hours a day for 3 months. And, you know, it's just one of those things where I feel that if you give any program a solid few days of your time, that you'll always find something that you can use it for.
Yeah. So, yeah, you would attest it to as close to traditional sculpting over other softwares?
Yeah, definitely. Absolutely.
Yeah. I have a similar way about it, you know, or I have a similar feeling is because I did a lot of traditional sculpting beforehand. And this is as close as you can get to as of right now. As close as you can get to traditional sculpting.
I think for excuse me, just getting over the the GDC sickness. I really think that there isn't any other 3D software out there that can do what ZBrush does, but there's a lot of ones that do certain things, you know, better, you know. And to each his own, you know. I just became really familiar with using ZBrush and tried getting into other things. Now, I love Modo. And I think I'm going to give Modo some more serious design time this year. That's one of my goals. And then I like what I'm seeing from 3D Coat, but like I still just don't think that it will ever. Nothing's going to replace my sculpting ability in ZBrush.
Right.
Not for the foreseeable future, at least.
Right. Well, I mean, they Pixelogic just completely paved the way for pretty much for the whole industry so far, right? And they're light years ahead of pretty much everybody else, in my opinion.
Yeah. It's, you know, right now, the rest of the industry, I feel, the rest of the 3D, at least the 3D software, is really just trying to catch up to the ease of use that is ZBrush.
Right. Well, the other thing, too, is that I love about, and by the way, we're not sponsored by Pixelogic, just to let you know.
Yes.
We are not sponsored by anyone. We have a common love of ZBrush. Crap, now I forgot what I was going to say. Awesome. Yeah, okay, cool. I totally forgot what I was going to say. So, you use mostly, like, are you just using Dynamesh, like, and then some clipping stuff and move brushes? Like, what are some of the tools that you're using so far?
Yeah, if you've noticed, I haven't even subdivided yet. That's a habit that took me a long time to get used to by not doing that kind of stuff. Mm. It's one of those things where I like to start real low and then build it up pretty high these days. Mm. I have more control and it lags on the machine less. However, ZBrush is pretty awesome for kit bashing models together and coming up with a design. But for the most part, I try to just keep everything low and just use the move brush to kind of get the shapes that I want, clipping and masking early on. Just trying to really get those shapes in there that I want.
Gotcha.
Without gooey.
Yep. So a couple questions coming in. Let's see. When using Dynamesh, if you toggle Dynamesh off and then back on again, does it subdivide the mesh once more?
No.
Negative, Ghost Rider. The pattern is full.
It just turns it back on.
Right.
And I believe if you turn it back, if you I think if you turn it off and you turn it back on, it will dynamesh the mesh.
Right.
The mesh.
Yeah. Right. So it's just like a re-dynameshing it.
Yeah.
Yes. So today, the green screen that you're seeing is all Justin. So we're just going to be basically watching him work his magic today. Let's see. Okay, yeah. So you're thinking right now of all the hard surface stuff, right? Whoa, what did you just do?
So what I just did there was I used the repeat key.
Oh, right.
So when I'm using my little neck cutting brush here, it's called the I can't remember where I got it or even if it's still available. I would give it out, but it's not mine to give out. As much as I would love to, but I think if you search on the internet far enough, you can find it. It's called a Mahcut, M-A-H-C-U-T. And he created a series of really awesome hard surface sculpting tools. Essentially what I do is if I lay down a line and I like how the line turned out, mm-hmm. like I can do it right here and show you guys. I could either try and go over that exactly again, or without moving the model, I can just hit the number one key over and over and over.
That's a repeat last action, right?
Yeah, repeat last action.
Nice. I always forget about that. Actually, you know what? I didn't even know about that probably until about a month ago.
Oh, really? Yeah, when I found that out, I was like, oh, man.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Oh, man.
It's a nice clean brush, especially at a high poly too. It's just something that I've gotten used to.
So you're working pretty low poly right now. How do you go about working with subdivision levels and stuff and higher resolutions and stuff?
So I try to break it up depending upon what it is. If it's a creature, then I can make it all one mesh. If I know it's going to be a robot, mm-hmm. I try to move very slowly and almost design it as if it's a toy. So when it comes time to, I guess, I want to say like posing it, it's a lot easier to pose it as if I'm putting it together a toy.
Hmm. And do you usually work with mainly just kind of one or a couple subtools, or do you get super subtool happy?
I get super subtool happy, especially with hard surface stuff. I mean, you know, you've seen some of the Bounty Hunter stuff that I've been working on.
Yeah.
Like, it's...
actually, I have no idea what you're talking about.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I mean, I don't know.
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
But yeah. So, like, right now, I'm just doing basic shape exploration. Like, I'm not really jumping into the high detail stuff yet. I'm going to do a little bit of, like, texture bombing just to kind of see what that's going to look like.
What is this texture bombing thing you speak of?
Well, texture bombing is something that I want to say I came up with, but I didn't.
We'll give you the credit. It's fine. I don't think I'm not sure if anybody here knows it.
Well, no. So essentially, I got the idea from going to Scott Robertson's one of his moto classes, right? Or not a class, but like a seminar that he did. He just like talking about the awesomeness of moto.
Wait, Scott Robertson's did a moto class?
Yeah, he does them from time to time. What? I don't know when the last time that he's done them. It was just like a workshop. You just kind of go there and ask questions and see how to do things and play around with the software. But it was really cool. So he showed us this process in which he figured out how to texture bomb things in Modo. And I was like, I don't really know Modo that well. Is there a way for me to do this in ZBrush? And there is, and it's a lot more controlled than the way in Modo, but I feel like that lends itself to be more beneficial to the artist. But I'm sure, not knowing my way around Modo, that there's probably a way to do it just the same way. But essentially what I do is I'll take car parts or motorcycle parts or anything, any texture you find.
Uh-huh.
and I will bash it on the surface of the 3D object using poly paint. And at that point, I use it to help me determine shape language, and I kind of just go around and draw and sculpt in what I see.
That is really, really cool for coming up with like random shapes, right?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
So are you gonna show that?
Yes, I am.
Yes. Really, honestly, guys. So this is actually the whole reason why I had Justin on today, because I wanted to see how he did that. So just let you guys know. My evil plan is coming together. So, do you usually do just busts, or do you do full characters? What do you usually find yourself doing when it comes to one of those two?
So for the full characters, it usually takes me a full day to get that done.
One day? Oh my god, I gotta get faster.
But, well, no, because it's not about speed, really. I just have a lot bigger asset library to pull from. So it allows me to make characters very, very quickly. You know, by no means don't any of you guys that are getting ready to get into the industry or anything like that, I'm so anti-speed. Like, don't get me wrong, it's great, and it allows me to go home and spend time with friends and family and that kind of stuff. But, like, when you're just starting out, that should never be the focus.
Right.
Never be the focus. And I feel that, like, there's too much of that going on.
Oh, I sculpted this in, like, 10 minutes, though it looks like a piece of poo?
Whenever I see that, I always, in my head, I'm always saying, yeah, I can tell. I can tell you did that. You know, and that's not the point. And that's not the point that the artist wants to get across, either. You know? And it's real simple. It's like, if you're not versed in the program, or even the pipeline or the work setting,
right?
Like, yeah, everyone's going to be so much faster than you. Like, that's the wrong lesson to take from it.
Right.
You know, speed comes with time and practice. Learn, it's like, you know, I'm still very much a student in regards of design. Like, I'm still figuring out what my personal tastes are. I'm still figuring out what I want to do. And you know, it's, as an artist, you're always going to be learning and always going to be growing. So enjoy that time. If you don't enjoy that time while you're learning and growing, then I don't know what to tell you. You're going to constantly be learning and growing in this industry.
Right.
I think I'm going to even stretch this out here just a little bit more.
So you've done enough of these types of demos while you're talking that it doesn't really bother you to talk and think with your right side and left side at the same time?
Yeah, it's weird. Like, normally, like when I first started out, I was like, oh god, this is the last thing I would want to do while I was trying to do it. But honestly, it kind of keeps your mind out of the way and just lets you do stuff.
Interesting. It's an interesting take on it. Of course, you know, I've been doing some streaming lately too, so a lot of the times it's actually nice to have that other side of your brain busy while while one side is doing the creative stuff.
I'm almost used to it at this point. You know, like once in a while I might get a hang up here and there, but like for the most part, it's become second nature, I feel.
That's awesome. I guess when you do it enough, too, right? Yeah. I think you've done this a couple times, right?
Just a few. But I mean, like, it's also one of those things where it's just like you're in a studio setting and you're chatting with your fellow artists while you're sculpting anything or,
right?
You know, it all relates back to that, so. It just, you know, I think it also helps too that like other people that are listening in and stuff like that, like they're not actually there in front of you.
Right.
The scary stuff is when you're in front of like an audience.
Oh, you actually see their eyeballs on you?
Yeah, and then you're like, oh, God.
Put your eyeballs away, bro. You're scaring me.
That's usually when you really, really got to scratch your butt.
Right, right, exactly. Or like pick your nose or something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's
I mean, clearly the outside of the nose, but anytime that, you know, the finger goes towards it, people are like, oh my God.
Exactly. Exactly. You know the fear very well.
Exactly. That's awesome, dude. All right. Hey, so I got a couple more questions here. So currently finishing, this is from Milky Bar Kid. What up, Milky Bar? Currently finishing school in Belgium, and I want to study even more, but maybe in America. Would you recommend a school? Thank you.
Let's clarify that. What would you like to do? Would you like to do 2D or 3D?
Duh, see? Good question. Hey, Milky Bar, you can throw a rebuttal question into just regular chat instead of doing it through the questionnaire, if you'd like to. And until then, we will get... Oh, that wasn't you. Never mind then, Milky Bar. Okay, whosever question that was, go ahead and throw a rebuttal into the chat. And we'll move on until then. So do you think ZBrush is further on in advancement due to higher user base and grinding the chaos that is ZBrush UI?
No, I think that if the sooner you get into this, the better. I mean, it's never been apparent also in the entertainment world that, you know, the people that are doing the production art are mm-hmm. using more and more 3D to get like photorealistic artwork.
Right.
In a short amount of time. And, you know, as far as that goes, like, yeah, as a 2D artist, it will behoove you to actually sit down and learn this stuff.
Right. Because that's kind of where concept design is going right now, right? Is 3D.
Yeah. I mean, it's definitely... I will never say that 2D will not have its place.
Right.
And that's definitely not the question or the remark that I want to make. I would say, if anything, you need to spend more time fundamentally in design than you do jumping into 3D right away. It just so happens that, like, you know, like I started doing a lot of graphic design, mm-hmm. you know, and did, you know, hell, I started out doing restaurant menus, you know. But now, you know, I had a little bit of a foundation, not as much as a foundation that, I would have liked to have. And mm-hmm. then I constantly try to strive and get that back into my workflow. But having a strong 2D background before jumping into ZBrush is just going to make you even more of a badass.
Huge, right? It's not about ZBrush skills. It's about design skills, right?
Yeah. And that's where I mean, like, there's a lot of things that are out there on the internet that are just tips and tricks or classes that are, you know, not really teaching you anything. They're just showing you the tricks and how to get something rendered.
Right.
Or, you know, it doesn't have to do anything with design, actually. But it's you just got to be able to see through that, you know, cloud of marketing and just understand what you're going to be learning. Right. And I think that if you have a traditional background, whether it's, you know, self-taught or even, you know, just self-learned, mm-hmm. I think that if you take more time understanding design fundamentals and 2D foundation, that your 3D will just be even better.
Right.
And I mean, there's several schools that I would recommend. You know, if you're just getting started or say you're just about ready to leave school. And you want to kind of attend a finishing school that doesn't have like a long period of time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's always Gnomon and there's Brainstorm. Taking classes online with your schoolism, that's definitely a way that I've seen people totally break into the industry.
Right.
Competitions,
would you say?
Competitions, definitely competitions, you know. ArtStation. you know, doing that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
It's always worth your time. Doing personal work is always worth your time. Even if there's a low paying job,
mm-hmm.
I'll say it time and time again, the time you put into a personal piece, you may not get paid right away from it. But you definitely will receive work because of it. you know, that a lot of younger students out there are headed that route, you know, and they're graduating and they're already like an internet sensation, which is awesome.
Right. Awesome. So by the way, he said that was Design Le Ponce. I think that's how you say his name. But he said he was working in 3D.
Ah. If you want to do design 3D, then you definitely need to hit up a design school. Like, you may know the I guess, how to use the functions within said program very well, but that doesn't mean you don't know a good ratio between, you know, areas of rest versus massive.
Right. Design emphasis will always win over specific software teaching, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Cool.
So now I think we're ready for this shape here. Let's start to see what we can do with some texture bombing.
Yes. All right, guys. Texture bombing. Here goes. Ready? Hit that record
now,
button.
You're going to see, like, this is how far I've gotten with just doing, you know, one out of a sphere.
Yeah.
Little detail. I don't want to. I didn't want to get into the detail. I just saw some curves and some lines that I really like, and I just want to keep that flow going when I do this process, right?
Right.
So here's where I divide.
Before you start, are you in Dynamesh right now?
Yeah, I'm in Dynamesh right now.
What resolution of Dynamesh are you at? I'm just curious.
Oh, so well, I was at. Let me see here. I was at resolution 72.
Okay, so super, super low.
Four times. So now I'm at like almost, 1.5 million.
So
and that's purely because the poly paint, I want it to be very clear.
So from what I've seen, this is interesting that you're using Dynamesh and Subdivision at the same time. Is there a reason why you're doing both at the same time and not one or the other?
Well, at this point, I could possibly just turn off Dynamesh.
Okay.
Because now I'm, I'm just at the point where I'm going to be laying this down.
Okay.
And I don't want to go to a lower subdivision.
Gotcha.
So
okay.
We're going to go to the RGB function up here and turn off the Z add. And I'm going to go in here to the stroke and do a drag react. So this is what I like to call texture bombing. And right now this is a picture of a motorcycle. And we're just going to start drawing it on there. And seeing what we can come up with. Let me fill this with a color here so we don't have a faded look there. Let's try it again. There we go.
Dude.
This
is like geniusness right here.
Seeing what I like. Like, I kind of like those lines. And I can always go back in here and paint some of this stuff out.
Right, exactly, because you're just using it as poly paint, right?
Yeah. And if, say it kind of faded off and you want it to be a little bit more prominent, you can just hit 1 again, and it'll lay down that exact same photo in the same place.
Do you ever use Z-Add or Z-Subtract when you're doing it?
Once in a while. The only really good effects that I've ever gotten that to work on is if it's a black and white image.
Interesting.
Like, sometimes I'll get that effect, but like, I would rather control that myself, and I'll show you how and what I mean by that. So I'm just taking that one photo texture right here. That's all it is, guys.
That's crazy, dude.
And I use this one a lot. It's actually probably time for me to grab another one. Because I use it probably too much.
Well, you can get a lot of longevity out of it, though.
Yeah, you really can. You really can if you keep your imagination open.
Right. The only thing that I wish that you could do is once you have the drag rec down in that particular location, I wish you could hit spacebar to move it.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. So, I just covered this guy, right? But it's not necessarily what we want for everything. So, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to turn off the texture. I'm going to go back to dots. I'm going to grab a square alpha, and we're going to turn on lazy mouse so I can really carve into this guy and paint. So now what I'm going to do is zoom in a little bit and take a look at this guy and see, what do I see? Is there anything cool that I like, you know, that I can see in this masked area? And there's a few things. So let me go ahead and sample this color here. And I can do that by hitting C, just like you would in Photoshop. And I don't like this part here, so I can just start to paint that out. And this now it becomes more, it feels more like a concept. Like I'm just painting on this on a 3D surface.
Right.
Paint that out if I don't want that there.
Yeah, that front portion looks pretty cool. Oh, dude.
Now I'm just sampling from the colors that are already there. And let me see here. I'll sample this darker color here and just underlay that shape here.
Chat's going crazy right now. They're like, oh my god, this is gold! This is, everybody's like holding their breath right now, like, oh, how did he do that? Oh, wait, go back. How did he do that?
That's funny.
Or at least I am.
You're like the only one.
Right? Everybody's like, yeah, we already know how to do this, guys.
Like, yeah, nothing new.
Justin's been doing this for like 3 years, bro. This is the first time you've seen it? No, man, it's a genius way to go of going about coming up with random designs and stuff. It's awesome.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a fun way to keep things going in an interesting way.
Yeah, total ZBrush hack.
Oh yeah. And this is, I mean, you know, this is really how I like to use ZBrush. And just really push that design element.
But do you do this also for organic?
Sometimes it works. Sometimes it doesn't. For hard surface, this technique is really really good using with photos. You know what I mean? Like it works very well when you combine them with your personal like photo library. For as far as the organic goes, you know, like I haven't really had a chance to perfect that kind of a workflow yet. You know what I mean? Like I'm sure with even more tools at my disposal, it'll just get better. But
right, it just means that you're gonna spend another 14 days on Pinterest gathering reference material for organic texture bashing.
Absolutely. And then I can do things like this. So this is a high res now, and I can choose RGB, and I can choose a darker color. Let's choose something that's already on that photo, right? Let me find a darker color. There we go. No, there we go. If I want now, I can trick the renderer into believing that that's a hard surface cut.
What?
Right? So by doing this with the mock cut brush and laying down a dark color with it at the same time, it really reads as a cut. See how like light is hitting? Or I can mask that out and push it in or pull it out or whatever I choose, right? That's how I kind of go along with this stuff. So it also, if I see like a dark line here, right, I'm just going to follow that dark line because to me, that means that it's a cut-in.
Right.
That's how I'm seeing it. So I'll just go along this edge and make sure that it registers as a cut.
Dude, that is so quick and easy.
It gets very, very fast. Very, very fast.
The nice thing is, too, that... Sorry. The nice thing too is that like you don't really have to. You can get into this amount of concepting very quickly, right? You don't have to do all kinds of crazy amount of base shape to get to this point.
No, you really don't. You really don't.
Oh, look at all that juicy little detail in the mouth area.
Right, you know, and then like, so I can do this kind of stuff right there. And then I can take my mask pen here, mask this whole section in, invert that mask, and push it in.
Damn.
Right? It already has that detail in there, and I can go in here and smooth it out if I want to.
Do it even more.
Really make the edges crisp. It all depends on. Oh yeah, that's actually a tip I should probably go over. So when you hit smooth, if you don't want to lose or blend those photos together, you really want to turn. Like when you're holding down smooth, you want to turn off RGB.
Yes.
Because it'll smooth the poly paint at the same time, and that's we don't want that.
Yeah, you don't want that. Now, do you ever go in and do like masks by value or masks by color when you're doing this?
Yes, I do, sir.
That's awesome. All right, you ready for a couple more questions while you're doing this?
Yeah, go right ahead.
Do you make your own brushes? And if you do, would you consider sharing?
I do. We have some, I believe that is on our Gumroads page. And you can look us up as Ironclad Studios. We have a bunch of kitbash brushes there. We have some ones that are going to be in development here pretty soon, which it will probably, that full set of kitbash shapes will be probably available, I want to say, in November.
Ooh.
So it's a little bit of a ways away, but... trust me, you're going to love it.
Cool. All right, there's your Gumroad plug for you, buddy.
Yeah.
So if you guys are interested in checking out his Gumroad, just put it into chat. So next question is, do you ever lose confidence in your abilities or in a project?
Always.
Pretty much every time, right?
That's the artist's lament, I think, you know. It happens to all of us.
Yeah.
One point or a time, or there will always be a moment where you're like, you know, I should be stoked that I'm working on something like this, but I'm really not, and that just means that you haven't had time to, like, I guess, do your own thing in a while, you know. Which the more and more I take time to do stuff for myself, the more and more I don't want to do it for other people. I would rather own that image, or
right,
you know. Just have that process down myself, and you know, create our own IPs. It's what everything at Ironclad here was kind of founded on. Definitely inspired by Dan Levizi.
Oh yeah,
he's a good friend. Yeah, I mean, like, he definitely, working with him definitely made me really want to do my own stuff. And
he's pretty inspiring when it comes down to doing your own IP.
Oh, hey, absolutely.
Well, inspiring altogether, but especially when you're talking about IP stuff.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we're all waiting for LMS movie. I think it'd be...
I'll be first in line with popcorn ready.
Yeah, exactly.
I cannot wait. Man. I cannot wait to see Dan's name huge saying created by...
Dude, right? Oh, man. So if you guys don't know Dan Levisi, go check him out. I'm gonna put his name in. Luvisi, right? Luvisi.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. If perchance you have no idea who Dan Levisi is, which may be like one person out of the 70,000 people that are here right now. No pressure, Justin. take a look at Dan's stuff, man. He is freaking amazing. Amazing. Just in case there's one person here. All right. So I was actually talking about this on my stream the other day about confidence and like your own particular projects and what you're doing. Like, I think that if by the time you're done with a project that you're working on, if you're 100, like definitely 100% happy with it, I think that you didn't. I think that you didn't push it far enough.
Yeah, that's true.
You know what I mean? Like,
if you're not uncomfortable doing design work, then you're not doing it right.
Right. Like, you should. You after a project, like even if it's, you know, 1 day project or a 3 month project, right? If at the end, like you're not, how do I put it? So, I think by the end of your project, you should be able to look at it and go, yes, I'm happy with it, but I know I can do better.
Correct.
Right? Because it's a learning process. Like every time, literally every single time you sit down and work on a project, you're learning something, right? Whether you've done it 1,000 times or not, right? And I think that the difference in your abilities, even if it's just a short project, of when you start the project and when you finish the project, you've grown, right?
Yeah.
So the things that you've done in that project, you're already better than that because you've finished it. You know what I mean? So if you're 100,000% happy with it at the end, I think I always feel like you didn't push it far enough, because you should feel at the end that you want to do it better next time. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. And that's one of those things where, you know, you just got to keep doing stuff.
Right.
You know, you just got to keep on keeping on. I know it sounds retarded, but
I feel like I've heard that somewhere, dude.
Yeah.
Is it like a song or something?
Pretty sure.
Yeah, pretty sure. Yeah, people are saying, yeah, I think half the world is going to be first in line for LMS movie.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's ask another question here. Would adding voxels or something like that to ZBrush make the program better and make it a bit easier to use?
Voxels. Possibly. You know, I don't even know. As far as I know, they could be integrating it right now. Mm. I can neither confirm nor deny. you know, it's one of those things where there's always a list of things that that can happen in the design process when they're re-upping new features for ZBrush. You know, there was a time where I remember distinctly that they would say that, you know, it'll never be 64-bit.
Mm.
It's just they have to. There's so much to tackle.
Yeah.
And change. And like right now, like it's, you know, it's just one of those things where you're going to have to give it time to kind of catch up. But for right now, I think that it would definitely help it, but I don't think it's needed. I think ZBrush is already kind of perfect in the way that it is. If it was just honed in on more of what it already does so well, I think they're going to be around for a long time.
Yeah, I don't see the difference between just pushing and pulling poly the way that ZBrush does and voxels as that huge of a difference when it comes down to making awesome art, right? Because like you could do so much just with polys. Now, you know, in ZBrush, just the way that it is. I think if it was having a tough time, then, you know, maybe something. But I honestly don't think there's that much of a difference when it comes down to the difference between the two. Although it is pretty cool to be able to sculpt in voxels. I do have to say that. I don't think it's 100% game changer, but
I think it has. I think there are ideas in that way of using the tool.
Mm-hmm.
That are game changers, but I don't know if it's going to be a game changer in the way that everybody thinks it's going to be.
As completely replacing regular poly sculpting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you see how, like, I'm not letting the photo actually dictate my cut lines.
Right.
But I am using it to kind of help me figure out, like, where I want space to actually happen.
Right. No photo. No photo.
I know, right? But there's this little section right here, so I'm definitely going to carve this out. maybe hit one more time, but I'll go back for sure. Like, I'll do it right now, actually. And just mask this part in. And just push that in just a little bit.
All right, just to give it some... Yeah, that's awesome, dude. Okay, on to the next question. You ready? I guess I should probably read these really quick before I say them out loud. That's awesome. So what is the process for retopology? Is it okay to do retopo after sculpting fine details? Is ZRemesher enough? Do you do much retopo?
I personally do not. I think that with the tools that are currently in ZBrush right now, it's probably a faster retopo. However, you know, there's Topo Gun that I've heard that's really good. Like, it seems like every week there's a new topology tool that just makes everything easier and better.
Right.
I would say that, you know, using ZRemesher on, you know, like, you clone your model, right? Your high-res DynaMesh model, which has got garbage topology. And if you copy it, and then you ZRemesh it, and then you subdivide and project, and you do that over and over and over, you will get a really, really nice effect. Mm. And I want to say it gets you at least 75% of the way there.
Right.
You know, and who's to say that, you know, that, you know, in the future, it's not 100%.
Right. Right.
You know, I'm waiting for the day that you'll be able to paint on edge loops and be like, this area has animation, you know what I mean? And you paint it in a certain way, mm-hmm. and it just adjusts the topology to do so.
Yeah, auto retopo 100% to exactly everything that you want it to be. Can't wait for that tool. That's going to be awesome. Yeah,
that'd be amazing.
Give us a little bit of background about now that we're like about an hour in, we can do mm-hmm. we can finish up the introductions. I think it's about that time. What do you think?
Yeah, that sounds about right.
So tell us a little bit about your background in case by the way, I did find one or two people that spoke up in chat that didn't know who Lavisi was. So awesome.
Oh, good.
Awesome.
Spread the word of the Lavisi.
Spread the Lavisi.
It's like butter.
It's like Barbara. She's like butter.
He also has he's got a Kickstarter. I think you can still get books if you want, though. There's that pop culture.
Oh, the pop culture stuff is. Oh, I totally back that. That was That was a hands down, no question about it. Yeah, that stuff is awesome.
Like, take my money.
Throws that screen.
Yeah.
A little bit of your background, like how you got started in all of this, let's just start with that. Then we'll get to Ironclad.
Okay. Yeah. Let me undo that. I didn't like that cut. It was here. Yeah, for me, you know, I started out in the early 2000s being a web designer. Right when I finished school, the market dropped out for that entire industry.
Wait, what year was that? Sucked.
Yeah, for graphic design and web design, it just became super easy. And, you know, kids in high school were charging just as much as other people to do websites. You know, it quickly became not a source of income for me. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it was a hard decision. I ultimately, you know, I realized that I had just spent all this money on school and I wasn't paying attention to where the market was going. And I made a very expensive, costly mistake. And, I ended up not doing anything artistic for... at least 8 years.
Oh. Ouch.
Yeah, I hated it. I hated it. I think I did like album covers for like my friends that were in bands and stuff like that.
Tattoo designs or something.
Yeah, you know, and it, but that, you know, never paid the bills. Nobody ever wanted pay anything for any of that.
Well, artwork should be free because it's fun, right?
Yeah, you know, you're going to do it anyways. Why can't I?
Right.
Right? But yeah, I mean, it's just one of those things where I kind of gave up for a very, very long time. And then I decided that I was going to try one more time. And that I was miserable working where I was working as a pizza delivery driver. And, you know, I was like, I'm not meant to live life like this.
Yeah.
I don't think anybody is, really. I'm a big advocate of people, you know, getting out there and doing what they want to do, at least trying. You learn so much about yourself.
Yeah.
By doing that, you know, man, I can go on for days
just,
about that.
Just trying to live and like survive in a world. In a world.
Yeah, it's like you just don't know, you know, I didn't even know that you could make a living drawing robots.
Right.
You know, that was never, no one ever told me. And if somebody told me, I would say, you know, you're full of it. But
right,
you know, it's definitely it was a hard battle getting here. It's not easy, and don't let anybody tell you, or even on, you know, Facebook, don't let anybody make you believe that, like, oh, it was just easy for that person. No, nobody wants to talk about the hard times. Mm-hmm. Nobody wants to talk about, you know, the fact that they survived off ramen for a month. You know, like it's. And I don't mean the good ramen.
Only a month?
Oh, dude, there was a time when I was attending Noman that I was literally living off of peanut butter and jelly and mac and cheese for over 4 months.
That's awesome.
My rent out here was $1,200 a month with no car, and the amount in which I was getting aid or government scholarships and stuff like that was only $700 a month. So full class load, plus that, you know what I mean? Like I lasted for almost a year and a half out here, before I hit trouble, and I had to kind of like stop going to school. Couldn't afford it, unfortunately. But, you know, I did take use of the time and really treat every homework assignment as a possible job interview, mm-hmm. you know, and that helped my chances, you know. I just wasn't here for no reason,
right.
you know. And I think that's an issue that happens from time to time.
I think it's interesting that, like, not interesting, but, like, you know, you kind of look at... at teachers, right? And it's not a glorified job, right? It's something that in order to be successful at it, like, you really got to have the passion. That's one thing that, like, I try to stay positive about this industry, is that, like, it's not a glorified position, you know? I mean, it is, like, once you make it, but the amount of time and effort it takes to get there is really trims the fat, you know what I mean? Like, people that are up there, like, that it's their life, like, that's what they want to do, that's what they live and breathe, like, every single day, you know?
Oh yeah. I mean, I, to be honest, like, I just want to do this for the rest of my life, you know? Like, I want to be able to design stuff or just play creatively in a setting that allows me to do that,
right? I would just be, I'm happy just getting paid to do something like this, right? Like, at least make a halfway decent living, right? I mean, hell, I'm just happy writing off video games for my taxes, you know? Shit.
Right? Are we all, sir?
Right? We're like, oh, you know, maybe this year I'll get a PS4 and then I could just write it off because it is reference. You know, it's hardware that I need to run my personal business. So, you know. That's what I do.
Yeah, that's how you got to look at things, man.
Right? if I can afford, you know, $450 or something, but, you know, that's beside the point.
That's the hard part, right? Is getting there.
Right. exactly. So you were delivering pizzas and you were living out of in a van down by the river.
Yeah, pretty much. No, I still live actually. I still live. I'm a block from Noman. I still live in my same apartment. I ended up getting an internship at a design studio, and then after that was done, I branched out and did freelance work, and got to work on Goosebumps and Maleficent and Planet of the Apes and a whole bunch of really fun stuff, and the list goes on. I mean, we've touched the Division. We've played with Halo stuff. I mean, it's kind of a dream come true in that regard that we get to, called in for those kinds of things now.
Right. So speaking of Ironclad, and so what made you decide to go the route of creating your own studio over trying to join an existing one?
Well, I saw, honestly, I saw what was happening to a lot of young talent. And one of the major things that I wanted to bring people in was I wanted to give them a place where they could grow and become a junior artist in the eyes of the industry and then never have to intern again. Because that's a problem out here, is that if you keep thinking that you're an intern, you will always be an intern. If you accept what they offer your first go, you're not playing the game right, which is something that's not really taught in schools. I remember I was getting paid like almost just a little bit above minimum wage to work on major motion pictures, and I
That's
just thought
crazy.
like, hey, that's probably how it is everywhere. No, I was dead wrong. I was absolutely dead wrong. And that's when I realized that people will take advantage of other people no matter where you are, no matter what industry. So I really wanted to have my own place where that doesn't happen. Like if you're working on a paid project here at Ironclad, you're getting paid.
Right.
Whether you're an intern, a junior artist, or whatever, I just don't want to be known for that. I don't want to put that vibe out there in the universe. You know what I
Yeah.
mean? Like, I'd rather be a positive influence. And, if someone gets a better job and they want to leave Ironclad or whatever, and all the power to you. I'd rather have friends in this industry than an enemy. Why?
Right.
I would never want to hold anyone back from making more money or getting an opportunity that I couldn't give them, or maybe I could help give them an opportunity.
Right.
I've had several interns come in and out of here where they're like, yeah, I want to work at Blizzard or I want to work at Riot. And I'm lucky enough to meet several of those people that work in those industries, and I will send out an email or a letter of recommendation. If that's your dream job, it would be my honor to help put in a good word. I'm not going to get you the job. You're going to
Right.
get the job on your hard work and your ethic and your
Right.
skill. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not really, it's not really, how do I put it? Me writing a letter isn't going to guarantee you a job, but I can help tailor your work ethic and your style to what you want to be and where you want to go.
Right. Yeah, I mean, that's a lot of the times people just need a introduction, you know? If you have the work, right? And maybe you're not the most social person in the world. Sometimes it's just about somebody seeing something in you and being able to, introduce you to the right people.
Yeah. I mean, it is about that, but it's also not about that. Like, if you could get along very well with anybody that you meet, right? That's not what the question is can you do the job as well?
Right.
I'll say it time and time again that, if you are an antisocial person, it's going to be very, very hard for you to get work in the film and video game industry. I'm not saying it's going to be impossible, but if you make it hard for people not to like you or even work with you in a professional setting, like that's going to hinder, and that word travels fast.
Yeah.
You just got to understand that, like, if people are saying no, it doesn't mean no forever. It just means no, not right now. It's
right.
Like, take the time to grow as a person, and get better at your craft, you know?
Right. Right.
A letter of rejection is only, you know, for that moment. They can't reject you forever. And the goal is just get so good they can't ignore you.
Right. So I've got a lot of people asking if you're hiring then.
I mean, we're always looking for new talent. Right now, you know, we are a little army of freelancers.
Mm-hmm.
And then we work on certain projects from time to time. If you're in the LA area, then definitely come by and schedule a time to come see us. We always, you know, love people coming in and chatting with us. If you're out of town or even in another country, we do that as well. But it's all dependent upon your skill level and if how fast you can work in dealing with all the different like time changes and stuff.
Right.
We have a couple really fantastic artists that I've worked with in the past. You know, we have a guy named Sebastian who absolutely blows everything he does out of the water. We just got a job in where I'm get to work with some level up people, and that's nice. Gonna be awesome. I get to work on a lot of different projects, but lately I've kind of been like, hey, I can see where this project is heading, and even though like I really want to work on said project, I might suggest someone better.
Right. Well, you got a company to run too, right?
Yeah, there is that too. But I mean, like, if I don't get in and start doodling, you know, I go a little crazy.
A little batshit.
a little batshit crazy.
Yeah, I hear that, man. Definitely. So yeah, Marcelo, I think we have a custom command for Nightbot in here that shows. Oh yeah, there it is. So Nightbot just put up ironcladstudios.com as well as justinfields.com. I believe that either one of them have a contact page, so if you're interested, I think you're probably going to get a lot of contact forms over the next couple of days.
That's okay.
But hey, you just never know. You know, you never know who's out there.
Never know. You know,
right.
A closed mouth never gets fed.
And that's it. That's all we need to do for today. Thanks, guys. It was a great stream. And
you're like, hey, wait a minute.
Words of wisdom via Justin the Goby Fields. So somebody was saying, like, specifically, what does it take to get a junior artist role at Ironclad? But I would say let's talk about junior artist roles kind of in general, and where do you see people that are trying to get into the industry, like where, you know, like how do you go about getting that first job?
That's always going to be the hardest thing to answer, because there are so many ways to get into the industry. And you know, what works for someone may not work for you, you know. I know of people that, you know, I've heard stories of, you know, people that did fan art and they did fan art better than the people that worked at the company. And mm-hmm. then they just get hired, you know, like, those are the awesome stories that you hear. And you're just like, oh, I love that. That's great. Like right. more of that, please. But you know, it's like a little bit of everything, right? You got to be able to show that you can do the workload, of original content. Not just fan art, you know, mm-hmm. but in some roles, you know, I think a lot of people are having a hard time understanding exactly what concept art is these days. You know, I see a lot of images that are definitely marketing images and not concept. You know, I all see people posting saying that it's a concept image and it took them 3 weeks to make. I'm sorry, but that would never fly in this industry. You do not get 3 weeks to do one painting.
Right.
Certain places Certain video game places actually want you to take 3 weeks. You know, there's places, you know, I don't want to speak out of turn, but, you know, like, deadlines for me when I worked for, you know, Riot and or Blizzard, they were extremely well organized in the fact that they knew that sometimes in order to get a good quality image, you can't rush something.
Right.
You know, and I love companies that think on that level, because look what they turn out. You know, Blizzard and Riot, like, they don't, you know, if it sucks, they don't put it out.
Yeah. Well, they trashed how many millions of dollars they spend on their Titan or whatever?
Well, I mean, I don't think that was a complete loss. I think that it was spent or turned into something else, which is what Overwatch is.
Right, but they were able to step back and say, hey, look, this sucks. We can't put it out, you know?
Yeah, I mean, they did it with Ghost, you know? As much as I really wanted a Ghost game, you know, if they say it's not up to their standards, then I'm going to listen to them. Yeah. They've never led me down a game development path that didn't make me love the game, and I think they're truly wizards of their craft. You know, they just know when to say no, and they know how to stand up. And same goes with Riot. You know, I'm always thoroughly impressed to see what comes out of both of those studios. Most definitely,
it's quite refreshing to see big companies like that, you know, stick to their guns about quality and not trying to make a buck, you know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely.
Call of Duty.
No, I know.
I love Call of Duty too, and I love their art, and I actually love the fact that we see new stuff like every year. I couldn't be happier, actually. So I'll go ahead and take that back.
I kind of wish they didn't do it every year, but, like, I gotta say, you know, I love it for what it is, and it's by no means like what it used to be. It's very arcade shooter style. And you know what? I'm totally okay with it. I don't care. Like, I don't have time these days to sit down and master a game. And if all I get is one chance to sit down for a half an hour and jump in there and kick some ass, then by all means, so be it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, so how do you stay current with references stuff? Like, do you play video games at all, or do you just go see movies?
I used to be a super hardcore gamer, and now I just don't have the time. You know, a friend of mine once told me I was pretty addicted to World of Warcraft for a long time. I probably gave that game 6 years of my life. Like, I was a hardcore raider for at one point. But you know, there comes a time where, you know, he told me, he was like, you know, there comes a time where you start making games and stop playing.
Yeah.
You know, and it's definitely been that way. And it's kind of cool. I don't get to, you know, beat everything on Legendary anymore,
right?
But it's definitely fun.
Yeah. Yeah. I still think that, so I tend to try to play games that are the style of art that I like, because I know I don't have a whole lot of time to play. So I usually will say, like, hey, I want to play Assassin's Creed Syndicate, not because I think it's, like, the most amazing game in the world, but I really, really love the art style, right? And it actually turned out to be actually a really fun game. I haven't had that much fun since before Black Flag. But besides that, you know,
oh my god,
dude!
Talk about, like, hey, stop doing the assassin thing and just make pirate games.
Seriously, can you just do this again and again? Please, oh my god!
I was at the seas, or on the seas, forever. I maxed out my ship before I completed the game.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I went and got, like,
in the corners, like, there were, like, massive monster ships or whatever.
Uh huh.
And I was like, oh yeah, I'm coming for you.
I've got my eye on you, legendary ship. Yeah, dude. Yeah, I would, like, go and try to find, like, all the little songs, like the extra songs that you can get.
Oh yeah.
Oh man, that was awesome. But yeah, so like I usually just try to do like the Division. I'm playing the Division right now because the character art in the Division, well, honestly, I think all the art in the Division is just amazing. The guys that put that together, man, just freaking killed it. The art is just so beautiful.
Oh yeah, I think it's one of the most beautiful looking games. I'm only like level 5 in it, and I play on Xbox, but like I really am interested in like getting a clan together and just playing a lot more often. But I just don't, it's so hard to find the time these days.
It is. It's tough. I went as far.
How the hell do you have time to do this?
Well, here's the thing is I you have to get really creative with your time when you're married and have a child and you're trying to work in this industry. Like, so what I did was I just got a second TV for the living room. So my wife has her TV where she watches The Bachelorette and all those fun stuff, and I sit and play Xbox or PS4 on the other TV right next to her, and we sit and we
My
hang out.
hero.
Right? Like, you just gotta get creative, man. There's always ways. There's always ways.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And then it's all about dedication too. Like I wanted to stream more often, right? Because like the Twitch creative community has been amazing. Like, there's so many amazing artists that are streaming. There's all you crazy awesome people that are hanging out today. Like, most of you guys are hanging out with me on a tri-weekly basis. And the people that hang out are just, it's an awesome community. But I wanted to keep doing it, right? But there's only so many freaking hours in the day, so you just got to get creative with when and how you do the things you do, right? So I figured that the only time that I could really do it was in the morning before everybody else gets up, right?
Yeah.
Like, well, shit, I guess I'll, 3 or 4 times a week, I'll stream from 6 a.m. to 8 a.m. and then I'll do my day. It's really whatever it takes to get the stuff done that's important to you, you know?
You gotta find the time and make the time.
All right.
And that goes with like just about anything, really. I mean,
Exactly. You have to find out what's
You
important to
don't
you,
want it as bad as the kid that's going to put 20 hours a day in. Then don't feel bad if that kid gets the job before you do.
You're right, exactly.
It's just like shit.
Yeah.
I mean, I know there's people that anytime you hear about another or a younger artist that's just really kicking ass and taking names, like there's always that initial like, oh man, he doesn't deserve it. Yes, he does. He put in the time,
He's working his ass off. There is no shortcut. There is no shortcut to being a good artist.
There is not. There is not. Especially in this day and age. You gotta be kidding me.
So, a couple more questions. Can you show again what really quickly how you did you turned on Lazy Mouse? Somebody else is asking about Lazy Mouse.
Oh, how to turn on Lazy Mouse?
Yeah.
So in my custom UI, I have it like up here, but you can go up in here into the stroke palette. And you go down, and there should be something called Lazy Mouse. And what I like to do is I'll take the lazy step down to zero, and then raise the lazy radius to about halfway, and that's about where I like it.
Oh yeah, you like it like that.
Oh yeah.
Lazy mouse. What's the fastest way to get a job in 3D? I can answer that one. Be awesome. If you have
Yeah.
awesome work, the opportunities will come to you as long as you're like showing it on social media, right? Like, get it out there, let people see, have awesome work. That's the quickest way to do it, right?
That is absolutely the quickest way to do it. And the cold hard truth, guys, if you're not getting the attention you deserve, you are not giving your sculpts or artwork enough time. Focus on doing good work. Doing solid designs, clean and pretty, and the work will come.
All right, and that's the blessing and curse of this industry, right?
It
Like,
is.
it's
And
literally.
I know like there's some people out there that are like, yeah, that's easy for you to say. And hey, you know what? I'm here to tell you guys, There is moments where I'm not booked for months on end. It happens to everyone.
Mm.
You know, you just gotta hustle harder, you know, or put in that time to do extra work, or plan. Heaven forbid you plan on, you know, on that happening. You know, take a look at where you were last year. And if you don't have any business in January or November, like, well, then you should plan on not having very much work in January or November.
Hmm.
Doesn't mean you should stop going after it, but you should definitely understand and take a look at what things are happening and when.
Right. And that's the awesome thing, is that, like, you don't have to have a Harvard degree, right? You don't have to be part of some exclusive club, right? You don't have to have the best interviewing skills in the world, right? You just got to have, like, good art, man. Like, you just, and that's the awesome thing, is that if you have good art, the work will come to you eventually, right?
Yeah,
but like, and that's pretty much all you have to do. Like, you focus on your art, you make your art better, and, like, it pretty much does the work for you.
It does. It will. If you let it. If you let yourself grow as an artist, that's when the work really comes in.
Exactly. So another quick question. I have the impression that to start in the industry and start well, you need to be in America. That's true. Absolutely. No, I'm just kidding. You can be anywhere in the world, man. You could be anywhere in the world.
Yeah. Yes and no. I mean, it's really, you know, like, I know that, you know, things in this industry are changing in that regard. And, you know, it doesn't really matter where you're at, you know. I mean, you still have the problem with the unions and that whole tirade of, you know, just trying to get noticed or who do you know.
Right.
In that regard, it always helps. It always helps to be here. Right. But, you know, I know several people that don't live in Hollywood that are absolute beasts in their industry, and they have no problem getting work because they focused on doing good work, you know. And I know it's hard because, like, you know, I still have a dream of, you know, doing stuff for Marvel or doing stuff for Star Wars. And who knows, that stuff may still happen, but I can't wait around for that to happen. I have to keep moving forward with my business or keep moving forward with my skill set. And you know, if the universe wills it, I know it sounds so hippie-ish, but, like, if the universe wills it, it'll happen.
Yeah.
If you want something bad enough, it will happen. You know, you just got to put your best foot forward, and you're not, dude, there's going to be so many people out there that are not going to get your way of thought. They're not going to like your, you know, how easy it was perceived that you got your job, or, you know, that way of thought. You know, there's a lot of people that are going to be very jealous that you got an opportunity the way you did. But you know what? Those are also the people that don't want to put in the time.
Hmm.
So, you know, just get used to that. It's going to happen. You know, you'll have people, you know, and consider friends, you know, talk mad shit all the time. And the industry's small.
Yeah.
So that's why I say, like, you know, if you're good, just keep being good.
Make sure to eat your humble pie every morning.
Eat your humble pie. You're not God's greatest gift. You never will be. Get used to it. You're here.
Well, now we're all depressed.
I know, right? You're here for a short time. Do what you want.
Yeah.
Why would you live life any other way?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I'd rather try to do something or try to work on a movie or try to do this than just sit at home and go, I don't understand why the phone's not ringing.
Right. Find out what you love to do. Do it, and then make it work.
Yep.
And that's the thing. If you're doing something that you love, it's not really work. You know.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Dude, by the way, this guy's looking dope.
Oh, you like this guy?
Yeah, he's pretty cool. I like him. You got my stamp of approval so far. Not that it really means anything, but...
All I was going for, sir. All
yeah. Oh, yeah. No problem for the answer, guys. We love all kinds of questions. It kind of helps, you know, get everybody kind of on... Not on the same page, but, you know, just different people from all over the world, and everybody has different opinions and different adventures and different life, so it's nice, like, having the questions and knowing that there's lots of differences out there, and you know what I mean? I don't even... That didn't really mean anything right there. It was just kind of a filler. Oh, man. All right, so do you tend to lean more towards games that reflect what you like to achieve in games, or do you lean towards games that you find fun?
Ooh, man, it's got to be a little bit of both, right? Because there's a lot of games out there that I think absolutely nailed a really, really cool look and mythos, and then in gameplay fell flat, and then they lost. In my eyes, like, that franchise is just dead to me. Right.
Mm.
You know, there it's stuff like that that happens all the time. You know, I think it's a little bit of both. Right. There's a lot of visual noise going on and a lot of, you know, just filler happening in a lot of video games due to time.
Mm.
But I think that certain companies are taking their time and developing new ways of thought. And, you know, I love that with programs like Substance and Quixel and Keyshot and ZBrush, they're not super expensive, and it's almost like opened up this floodgate of supreme talent to get their hands on the software and really take it to a whole new level or really break the boundaries and figure stuff out. And I think it's a great time for an artist, you know, even to be able to get their hands on Unreal, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Blew my mind.
Or Unity, or even, what's the new one that just came out? Amazon's Lumberyard, right?
Yeah. I mean, it's all awesome in that regard, in my opinion.
Yeah.
I think this is a great time. I think you're going to see, depending upon a game, like the need for the mega office and an army of people to do a game, I don't think that's going to be needed anymore.
Yeah, a little bit like what the indie game industry has done for game development.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Are you coming to this year's IFCC?
I am. I am one of the speakers.
Snaps! Unfortunately, I will not be. I haven't made it to that status yet. I don't even get to attend. It's in Croatia. I can't make it. Oh yeah, Frost.
I'm sure you
Frost
get that call soon, brother.
Yeah, one of these days. It's okay. One of these days. But I mean, honestly, like having a family, it's a little bit tough to kind of move. You know, fly to the other side of the world. Some people can make it work, but
it's dude. I don't even know how you would. Like, I have 4 dogs, and it's already...
Yeah, that's true, right?
...insane to try and find dog sitters. I mean, like, I have a few friends that do it on the regular, and thank God for them, because otherwise I would not be able to do much of anything.
Yeah. But you find a way, though, right?
Yeah, find a way.
Definitely. And you're going to be at THU as well?
Yeah, I'm going to be there at THU. I am not a speaker at THU.
Well, that just means you get to have fun, right? And you'd sit and watch other people sweat it out on stage?
I'm very certain that Andre will put me to work. Okay. I absolutely love going to THU, and I am extremely thankful for everything that, just by attending and speaking there, that it's done for my career in general. So I mean,
yeah.
And not only that, I mean, it's just a fantastic event. It just really, really is.
Wait, THU or IFCC?
Both of them, to be honest. You know, I think they both have their strengths and their weaknesses, but I really absolutely love going to events like that and workshops. And that's another thing that I would probably step on is, like, I know these things are expensive, guys, but you know what? Do you want to shake hands with people that, you know, are your art heroes and get to know them? And you know, these are the connections that, you know, if you can't get noticed online, then go show them.
Right.
Show them. I mean, like, it's only going to be beneficial to you in that regard. You know,
right.
It's just worth it, you know. And every time I go to one of those things, I'm super inspired for the entire year to come.
Right. And that's what GDC is for me too. Like, you just go and being around those people just gets you so motivated. I mean, I was sitting there watching Glauke Longi's Substance Painter demo, and the only thing that I could think of was like, oh my god, I just want to go home and work and do what this guy's doing right now, because he makes it look so damn easy. You know?
Yeah. I mean, that's kind of the part of it, you know, is like going out there and getting inspired. The moment you feel uninspired, you need, as an artist, in my opinion, I need to be inspired. I can't wait. Unfortunately, I can't wait for inspiration. But, you know, it's one of those things that I can definitely feel it tug on my brain when I don't get it, when I don't get my newest, coolest thing, or, you know, I haven't seen something from an artist in a while, and you got to go, like, you know, poke them and make sure they're alive type thing.
Right, right.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, you just got to constantly do that. And, you know, like, places like ArtStation, dude, that website, I think it gets some ridiculous amount of hits per day, like
70 gajillion.
Yeah, you know, it's pretty impressive, but like just by looking at that number, right? And I don't want to misquote it, but I mean, I was told a specific number, and it's jaw dropping on how many, you know, visitors it gets. But that just goes to show you how many of us all think the same way in that terms. Like, we need to be fed our daily inspiration of cool stuff, or just a way of looking at things and how other people do it, you know?
Right.
You know, I wait on bated breath for anything that Bjorn does.
You and me too, man. I'm like, Bjorn, dude, you got to put out some more stuff, man. We're dying over here. The same thing with Merrick, right? I haven't seen Merrick.
Oh, yeah, Merrick as well. Merrick, Jesus. Both, dude, those guys are too damn good.
Oh, my God. It was like, can you please just put out more stuff, please, because I can't, like, the time in between one or the other is just it's too long, man. I'm starving over here, bro.
We're starving over here.
Starving.
I saw Bjorn do a really awesome demo at IFCC, and I was just like, man, I gotta get back into painting, where, you know, I rely heavily of doing a lot of my painting techniques within ZBrush and then just letting it render and then painting on top.
Yeah.
But that's just because that's how I was trained. Like, it wasn't, knowing what I know now, I would probably go back and go, yeah, that's probably might not be the way to do it, but it worked for me.
Right.
You know, it all depends. Everyone learns in different ways. And I think that you have to be open to that. And it's also about questioning what's come before you. You know, what works for some people just might not work for everyone. So if there's new tools out there and new ways of thought and new ways to do things, then why would you not want to try them?
You're right. You should always be continuing to evolve and grow.
Absolutely. I mean, like, I'll say that, like, you know, when I first went to Noman, all I wanted to do was be a concept artist, you know. And there was even teachers there that would be like, you know, hey, it's really, really hard to do that job. We want to train you to be successful and that kind of stuff. And they mean well, and it is a hard position to get into, right?
Right.
It's very, very hard. But what I took from that was, you know, like, oh, well, then I think, you know, I took a matte painting class and I really, really loved matte painting. And I was like, you know, well, maybe that's my backup plan. And I still want to do more of that stuff. So, you know, getting into that mindset really, really helped me know that not just in concept art, and especially even with ZBrush, With the amount of time that I put into this program, I know now that I can use this in any industry, and I have. You know, I work for the Department of Defense.
What?
Yeah, I mean, it's not just movies and games. You know what I mean? Like, you take a look at like what Dominic Quek is doing with his own creature line, and that's freaking awesome.
Jewelry design. There's all kinds of crazy stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure if he's listening, he's just throwing his fist in the air at me, saying like, "Justin, when are you going to do one of yourself?"
Seriously,
as soon as I have time, I really want to. Man, I really do. But you know, things at Ironclad are changing, and you know, we're gonna have access to our own 3D printers here that are all super nice. Equipment and all that kind of stuff, and you know, we're growing as a company, and it's exciting. I'm hoping that we get a chance to put out our own video game this year.
At least
showcase our IP that we've been working on, you know, in our spare time.
Right. All the spare time that you guys have.
Yeah, but we don't really have a lot.
Exactly.
But that's the problem, right? So I'm essentially what I'm trying to do at Ironclad is set up almost like a workflow, or even the amount of clients that can come in. If there's a lot of clients, then I can build my little nucleus of, you know, badasses that just sit in a room and make IP all day long.
Mm-hmm.
But we can work on client work too, but like, I really truly feel that like that's the way to go.
Right. There's all kinds of people questions now.
Okay.
What kind of video game will Ironclad be doing? What? Ironclad's working on a video game? Stop it!
Right now, it's
stop it.
Classified as a space western.
What? Cat's out of the bag, guys. You heard it here.
Cat's out of the bag.
So yeah, you'll probably see something in like 10 years.
Yeah. How it's been going? Yeah, probably. You heard it here first from Brandon.
You heard it here first. Oh, Firefly! Somebody said.
Mm. Yeah, yep. It's very, very. I won't say that it's not very Firefly inspired. Considering I'm looking at Captain Malcolm's gun right here on my desk.
Yeah. Right.
anyways, you know.
Yeah, yeah. So
if you know me, you know that I'm just absolutely apeshit for Star Wars. Love it. I've always loved it. And I know that by saying that publicly, that might ruin the chance of me ever working on it. But that would be living a lie, and I don't want to do that.
I guess that puts out any work for Star Trek, huh?
I would, you know, Star Trek? I would love doing Star Trek too, man. I would love to do that. I think that... you know, JJ's take on that universe is definitely very cool. I don't think we'll ever get to kind of see that again.
Yeah.
He's kind of stepping away and doing Star Wars. But, you know, I could go on for days of why I think that was the better choice. And thank you
for everything. Right?
Star Wars again.
Yeah, thank you for doing Star Trek and then proving that you can do Star Wars. And then just redoing Star Wars.
He's the king of nerd culture, in my opinion, man. Right now.
It's crazy. That guy is, yeah.
So good.
So good. So good. All right. There's a couple more questions. On the opposite end of having, all right, this is a long one, so be prepared. Okay. Ready?
Yeah.
On the opposite end of having confidence in the drive and the art to work in the industry, is it a bad thing to have little or no confidence in interviews or in your own work? And B, what would that stop you from hiring or recommending someone?
Wait, so
too long.
Read that one more time. Read me the first half and then read me the second half.
All right. Here. On the opposite end of having confidence and drive in your own work, is it a bad thing to have little or no confidence in interviews?
Yes. And I'll tell you why. If you got the interview, they're interested.
Right.
As a person that on a studio side, that I mean, like we get unfortunately we get too many emails for me to follow up on, and I really do try to send an email back. And for what I'm about to say, I hope that isn't taken in any other way, but I just haven't had a chance to get back to each person that has ever emailed us.
Right.
However, the fact remains that if they're really into you and they want to hire you, the interview, them giving you the interview, is them taking time out of their day. So they're already interested. Don't let anybody tell you any different that that's not what's happening.
Right.
The interview is your opportunity to literally talk them out of you
getting yeah, right, exactly.
I mean, just be polite. Don't fanboy, even though it's super, super hard. Trust me, I know. I am a fanboy of a lot of things, and it's very hard not to geek out when you get certain phone calls.
Yep. Just geek out afterwards. Like, walk out of the door, walk out of the building, go around a corner, and then just, yeah! All right?
Yeah. Yeah, you got to do that.
So, like, and correct me if I'm wrong, but in my experience,
you're wrong.
Thanks. sweet. I've been doing everything wrong then. That's why. Ah, got it. So usually the way it goes is somebody sees your work. If they like your work, then they'll contact you, right? And
yeah.
If there's a position open, then 9 times out of 10, they're going to give you an art test.
Yes.
Right? If they like your art test and they contact you again saying, we'd like to interview you, you've pretty much got the job, right?
Yes.
Like, they like your work. They think that your they literally think that your work on the art test was good enough for them to take the time out of multiple people's days to sit and chat with you to make sure that you're cool, like you're a person that they could work with, right? So it's literally just like, hey, is this guy not crazy, or is this lady not crazy? Like,
yeah,
that's about really what the interview is, right? It's not like an interview for like a tech job or something, right? It's not like it's not like a regular interview. It literally is them seeing if you're an okay person, you know.
In this industry and in video games, it's not unheard of for you to work 14-hour days occasionally. Not all the time,
yeah,
but it happens. And interviews are literally, hey, if I got to work 14 hours in an office, am I going to not kill this guy? You know, like,
right.
I got to be able to, you know, work with people and get along with people in that kind of a setting. And that's where I'm saying, like, know your social cues. And I know that a lot of us are, you know, I wasn't always this way. I was very introverted with a lot of things, you know, especially with my art. Like, I didn't want to talk about my stuff or even get in front of people and show it, you know. Like, I thought that was the scariest thing ever. But, you know, it all comes down to, you know, like, how bad do you want it?
Right.
If you don't want it that bad, then someone else is going to take that opportunity.
Right.
So
just don't be psycho about it.
Yeah, I mean, if you know that you're not good at it, then that is one thing to work on. Should you put it over doing good art? No. You shouldn't, you know, because there's always the exception to the rule, right? But in my opinion, I think that knowing how to be, you know, just how to present yourself in a social manner, or even, you know, just having manners is a rare thing.
Right.
Especially out here in California. You know, every day I see people that are just absolutely rude on the street for no reason.
Yeah. Well, you're in Hollywood, so that's kind of a normal thing, right?
Oh, yeah.
That's awesome.
Unfortunately, yes.
Yes. Yep. It's almost like, have you been to downtown Santa Cruz?
No, I have not.
That Hollywood is interesting. You gotta just spend a couple hours in downtown Santa Cruz, California, and you'll see some very, very, very interesting things, man.
Yeah, okay.
But yeah. Okay, so I got another question. You ready?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, by the way, so this is your 20-minute mark.
We've only been doing this for 20 minutes.
Yeah, we've only been doing this for 20 minutes. Just want to let you know that you've got about an hour and 40 minutes left.
Seriously?
No.
I was like, wow, I might actually get to paint this thing.
Yeah, I know, right? So we're scheduled for like another 20 minutes, but if you've got the time, we can go as long as you want.
We'll see here. I have to take in consideration that that's actually another point I probably should talk about, guys, is I worked way too hard last year and I permanently damaged my shoulder.
Oh no.
That will never go away, guys. Everyone, it is important. It is imperative. Even, you know, a lot of, you know, people out there don't think it is. It's very important to take care of yourself and get up and take breaks, you know.
Damn, dude. I didn't even know that, man. You're going to survive? You're not going to croak on us, right?
No. I'm not going to die. I'm just saying that, like, you know, I have to take breaks because for a long time, and being a business owner, you know, you tend to work long hours, whether you want to or not, you know. I probably am on my second year of just doing work, like, all the time. How do I put it? Like, I'd say on an average, my work week is every day I'm at least 12 to 14 hours. But it's not because anybody's making me do it. It's because I want to do it. I want to see my business grow. I want to make the right contacts. I want us all to work on fun stuff. So, you know, it's up to me. No one else here is going to, you know, bring us work if I don't do it.
Right. Yeah. And this is what I always try to tell people too, is that there's a fine line between spending enough time and spending too much time, right? Like, you gotta take the quality of your work into how many hours, right? This is just like when you were studying for tests back in college or in high school, right? Like, do you stay up all night studying, right? Or do you go to bed, get some good rest so that you can make smarter decisions at the time, right?
Right.
So it's always like a give and take with, you know, do I just try to sculpt the crap out of this for 14 hours? Or do you, like, step away, take some time, and then come back and make better decisions than you would have if you were still sculpting on it?
That's the fine line, right?
I mean, right.
And being a freelancer, some of you that are, you know, you know that it's like turning down work feels like you're getting a root canal. Like, you just don't want to do it, so you take on too much. You know, I recently did that with the job, and nothing feels more terrible than letting someone down thinking that you were going to be able to do something in a time frame that you weren't, you know.
Right.
And, you know, that can burn a bridge. You know, thankfully it didn't, but, you know, I'm very aware of it now, and I don't ever want to do that to a client ever again.
Right.
They are your lifeline. You know, you're not doing them a favor. They're, you know, like, it's kind of like a give and take kind of thing, right? You know, you want them to always come back to you, but you can't let them abuse you.
Right.
Type thing, right. Right. So, you know, and I'm sure that there'll be some comments where, you know, it sounds like I'm contradicting, but it's just like, hey, look, you know, if someone you want to work with isn't very sure about what you're doing or how they want to work with you, and you want to do a test image for free because you believe in the product, then do that. But if they're outright asking you to do free work, I mean, they're not on your best side anyways. Then.
Right.
You know, so it's just one of those things you got to be careful with, you know.
Yeah.
Not every scenario is cut or is a clean cut, right? It's not an absolute rule. You know, I've broken my rule of doing free work before, but it's for projects that I believe in, that I, you know, whether they want to give me a chance or not, I want to prove to them that I want to work on that project.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. It's a crazy world out there, man.
It is. It is a very crazy world.
So I just getting back to your sculpt here. I like the fact that You still are able to go in and do like overall large changes, even though you have all this fine detail. That's the awesome thing about ZBrush that I love, is that like you can still go back and do all those huge, huge changes, you know?
Oh yeah, absolutely. And I can, you know, I can go in there and start using, you know, a lot more like hard surface alphas. In fact, I'll probably start doing that now.
Okay.
I mean, it's pretty awesome in that regard to do that kind of stuff. But you have to kind of choose your battle and make sure that you're doing the right thing.
Right. And that's the one thing. I mean, that's one of the, probably one of the main things that I love, other than undo, with digital sculpting over traditional sculpting. There is no move tool in clay.
Yeah.
Like, oh, let's make this bigger. Crap.
Yeah, you're just like, oh. Hmm.
Yeah, that's not going to work. I have to resculpt everything. Damn it. All right, I got a couple more questions. How do you feel about the growth in technology for our field like 3D scanning? I find it fascinating and exciting, but a lot of 3D artists I know see it as the death of 3D art in their careers. How do you feel about it?
I feel that if they're truly scared of it, they got to get better. It's not going to replace them. You know what I mean? Like it's still, as if it's art, it still has to be ran through an artist. Someone has to sign off on it. I wouldn't worry about it too much.
Plus you can't, there is no this guy that you're making, right?
Right. Yeah. I mean, like at some point, like that, you know, they're still going to need an artist to touch it or to clean it up or whatever.
Right. Yeah, I would. I see scanning as augmenting and not replacing.
I think it's going to speed up your workflow.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just another tool, right? Like, it's just like starting from a base mesh, right? Like you know, that probably won't. I mean, even in they did 3D scanning in the Order 1886, right?
Yeah.
But that wasn't the end of the project, right? You still got to create all the clothes. You still got to, you know, clean up the scan. You still got to do all the texturing and you know, there's just a shit ton of stuff you still have to do. If not, it's just like starting from a base mesh, basically. That's how I see it.
Yeah, none of that stuff is going to work flawlessly out the gate either.
Right.
You gotta be able to choose that stuff better, you know. Let's see here. It's a hard question to answer, because yes, there's always going to be something in the future that will possibly take over your job, right? But if you're going to constantly look at things like that, like, oh man, I don't know what to tell you. Like, I think that, you know, you're going to wake up every day in your life and go, yep, something out there is going to replace me. I think it still falls down to get so good that they can't replace you.
Right.
You know?
So somebody else also was at Osco. Today's my first day of the new tongue. replaced it just for this stream, guys.
Noise.
How did you sample the colors when you were painting your model? You want to show that again real quick?
Yeah. So just like in Photoshop, you know, if you hold down, excuse me, there's a motorcycle just somewhere. If you say, like in Photoshop, you can hold down Alt and color pick. Mm-hmm. You can do the same thing in ZBrush. It's the letter C. So as you, if you watch over here, I can sample around to any of these colors, and it will automatically pick that for me.
So it's like holding Alt right in Photoshop.
It's just like the eyedropper tool.
Yeah, so C on the keyboard. That's C for cat or C for color. Yeah. Ooh.
kind of like that.
It's like a not a microphone, but a speaker.
Yeah. No, I like that even better.
Okay, so now that we have about 10-15 minutes left, let's talk about ArtStation.
Okay.
So ArtStation, in case you guys don't know, for some odd, again today with a new tongue, I apologize. Hold on, I need more coffee. Hold on.
Yeah, I was like, maybe that's the problem.
So this is the time in the broadcast where everybody needs to take a large drink of coffee. Okay, good to go. So yeah, ArtStation. If you guys don't know, there's the first of what we possibly think maybe more than one ArtStation challenge. and in case you didn't know, also the one and only Justin the Man Goby Fields is one of the judges. So tell us, how did this come apart? How did it come apart? How did it come together?
it's good. Killing me, Smalls.
I know, man. I know, right? Can you tell? So how did it all come together? I think it's the caffeine. It's Pete's coffee. That's why I'm all jittery.
Okay, that explains
too much.
No, honestly, there wasn't much to it. I mean, we currently are also at Ironclad, starting to do I think we're going to try and put on a yearly monster challenge, which will be fun. But honestly, Leo just kind of came to us with this idea.
Wait, who's Leo?
Leo is I believe the guy in charge over there, the man in charge at ArtStation.
The Ninja Turtle?
Yes, Leonardo and Michelangelo. Leo Toe. I hope that I'm pronouncing it right. I hope so. But anyways, he reached out to James Paik and I and talked to us about becoming the first hosts of the challenge. And it's funny, we thought we could totally handle it, but it's reached so many users that I think we're actually going to have a meeting this week about bringing in additional guest hosts. To help us critique everything.
Well, you can't do right like 700 critiques, dude.
Yeah, we're gonna give each one a critique as part of the contest, I believe. I don't know if we're gonna be able to do it to all of them, but for a majority of them, we would like to. Hopefully, that happens.
That'll be I mean, that's quite a load.
It's a tall order.
Yeah,
it's a tall order. But, I think we could do it. It's definitely a weekend.
Yeah, exactly. Over lots of beers, right?
Yeah, lots of beers over a weekend. Maybe, who knows? Maybe we could talk John Park into coming on board and helping us do this insane challenge that we agreed to do.
You're like, what the hell were we thinking, man?
Yeah, like, I don't have time for this. Do you have time for this? No, okay, we need help.
Yeah, exactly. But it's really cool. I mean, I think it just lends to the fact that, ArtStation has become a huge, huge asset for the art community, Just seeing how much, how much art is up there and I was like, God, man, you need inspiration? All you got to do, just go to ArtStation. Just go to the front page, man, like within about 10 seconds, 1 second, you'll just be like, okay, got it. Okay.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's just pretty much how it goes. I literally start my day out with an ArtStation, like, look around for sure.
Right. And it's really easy to get down about your own work, too, when you look at it, right? So just keep that in mind.
Yeah, it happens. It happens for sure.
Yeah.
But I think that if you take everything in that light, like it's gonna be a hard time not seeing everything as a negative.
Yeah.
So you really got to work around that and be like, okay, well, if this is what I like, then how do I get to that level? And how do I get to that standard?
Right. If not only that, like this is the stuff that's possible.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Definitely. Right? I think that if you live in an environment that's very negative, and I can attest to this, you know, like where, you know, where I grew up and some of my even my family members, they still don't get what I do. Like they're waiting for me to call them still and be like, hey, can I crash in your basement for like 6 months? Because my life doesn't work out. You know, like, that stuff happens to the best of us, right? But they just don't get that this is an actual career path. And to those people, you know, it's just like, it's a hard sell. So, yeah. But it definitely affects you as an artist. You know, if you're around that, you really gotta, you know, I say it all the time, you gotta surround yourself with positive people and the change will happen however you want it to be. You know, you just got to. You know, when I came out here to Southern California, you know, I didn't know anybody. My closest family was super far away. And, you know, so I just kind of surrounded myself with people that were super positive and, you know, they worked in the industry. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't like I was using that as like a way to get in the industry, but, it kept me very positive. And as an artist, you know, I think we all have that tendency to get really dark and down on ourselves very, very quickly.
Every day, pretty much.
Yeah, every day.
Oh my God, my art sucks. What the hell am I doing with my life?
That's a terrible way to live. And yeah. I don't wish that on anybody. And, you know.
Yeah.
I think that another great thing to listen to, I mean, if you listen to either Bobby Chu's Perfect Bait, that's a great book.
One of the best 10 bucks I spent, man.
Oh, easily. And also, Noah Bradley's The Art of Freelancing.
Yeah.
That taught me a lot. I still listen to it to this day.
Yeah.
When I need a little bit of a refresher. I mean, we're not really freelancing anymore, but
it still applies, though.
The company, it still applies, absolutely. Yeah.
Okay, 2 minutes. What do you got?
2 minutes, okay.
Now, we can go, you know, wherever however long you're comfortable with.
I'm trying to see here. We'll keep going, and then we'll see how my shoulder feels, and if I feel like I need to take a break, we might call it. But
okay,
I'll finish this painting up and post it and give it to you to post on your site.
Yeah, can you, before you go, show us a little bit just quickly how you get your renders out and get them into Photoshop in case people are interested in doing that?
Yeah, I mean, how much time do you have?
However much you want. It's almost 4 o'clock right now, so it's only, you know, however much time that you feel like you need.
Well, let me see here. So I can either do it the KeyShot route or I can do it the ZBrush route. The ZBrush route is a little bit more extensive mm-hmm. in getting it how I want it to be.
Well, let's do KeyShot because I want to know KeyShot too.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, let me see here. I'm trying to figure out if I want to make the base bigger. Let me see here real quickly.
Hey, Chu, Bobby Chu. Is it C-H-I-U?
Yeah, I believe so.
Okay.
I don't want to misquote the name. I'm terrible with names.
So, and that's an iOS app. That's at least what I have it on.
Yeah, you can get the audiobook for cheaper, mm-hmm. than I believe.
Yeah. And the other one was Noah Bradley. I'm just writing it in mm-hmm. for people who want...
The Art of Freelancing.
Yeah, The Art of Freelancing. The Art of Freelancing. There you go, guys. Don't mind me, I'm just typing in chat back here. I think my keyboard is pretty loud, so sorry about that. I do, I have a lot, like, I was listening to some of my past streams, just to kind of get, like, an idea of what all you guys are experiencing. and I was just like, oh my God, my keyboard is so loud. Like, oh my God. It's so annoying.
So loud, oh my gosh. Do you have a mechanical one?
No, it's like a Logitech, but you know how some of them, like, you just, like, you touch it and it makes a sound, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, ugh! Just like
That's usually how it goes with me at night by myself.
that. Well, this got a little awkward, boys and girls.
This got strange
Yeah.
real quick.
With the quick. No, it's all good.
So yeah. Well, you know, and see, I just want to keep noodling on this, but we'll jump into
See what you
something
got.
real
See what you
quick here.
got. Are you using the Pro version or the HD?
I don't know. I have a couple versions. I can't remember. Let's see this one. Do that later. All right, so let me choose my external renderer key shot. Let's go ahead and send that over. And I will bring as soon as it loads into key shot, I will bring it over into there we go. Into this window so you guys can see it. Well, maybe. Let me minimize this here. There we go.
Key shot. Yeah, just those plane differentials. The
Differential.
plane differentials will be are awesome, right? Just by like doing that quick little, was it ma brush, ma
Mock
cut,
cut.
ma cut. Yeah, just by doing those little things, man, it really just very quickly looks freaking awesome, man. And that's the thing, right, for concepting is just getting the idea down quick, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Does the latest KeyShot support PBR workflow with Substance or Quixel? I don't think so.
I don't think so. No, I don't think it does either. I mean, you can use this is like a template to kind of figure out what it's going to look like with realistic lighting.
Right.
And you can see if the forms are going to read as well as you want them to read.
Right. The thing about
But yeah, I never
PBR
thought
is
about
that
it.
you really have to have UVs for PBR to work like best, right? And that's the
Yeah.
huge difference between KeyShot and things like Quixel or Substance Painter is that this you don't have to have UVs at all, right? It's just poly paint mixed with some materials,
Yeah.
right? And
Yeah.
that's the beautiful, beautiful thing about KeyShot.
Yeah.
But it is rather limited when it comes down to doing like painting in specific areas and all the stuff that you could do with Quixel or Substance.
Yes. It definitely lends itself to that. But so like right now, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to fill this with that material. So let's do color, fill object. And now I'm going to choose, let's see here, let's choose base material one. And all I'm going to do now is I'm going to start picking out some things that I want to be different as far as geometry goes.
So you're just painting in material?
Yeah, and I'll show you why.
What?
So that's a specific material, right? So we'll hit BPR and we'll go back to KeyShot. So now what I can do is I can double click on these and that should be a separate material. And if I go in here and go to, say, emissive or, let me see here, point light or area light, let me see what that does.
Oh, you just have to turn go back to emissive and then just crank your power to like 10,000.
Okay, there we go.
Or
Wait.
intensity. Yeah, take your intensity to all the way like way up. Like even beyond that. So just type in like 100. Or maybe 10,000. It's crazy, like I was doing this the other day, try 100,000. It was like the scale is like way off. No? Okay.
Let me try it with
Yeah, try it with the other one. Area light diffuse, yeah.
Maybe it's I always get confused with this. So that was area light, point light diffuse.
Oh, the wattage, yeah. I think it has like a weird scaling thing. So if you turn it up, if you like type it in as like 10 times or 100 times what it's already in there,
yeah,
then it will come in, or at least
Shame.
Should.
It doesn't do that. But the other thing you could do, I'm not sure why it's not doing that. Okay, so that's okay. What I can do now is.
You could try Lumen, too, for the other one. Either way, yeah.
Let me go back in here into ZBrush real quickly. So what I can also do, if in case that doesn't work, let me just zoom in here and just undo that change, right? Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab my masking brush, mask that pen out. And let's do mask pen. Let's choose a little circle alpha. And what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna draw in this little area here. And then what you can do is go into your subtool section here and extract that.
Yeah, that is another way to do it.
You know, that's a little too much, so we want to go there we go. Just break that a little bit. That's about right. Hit accept. Clear that mask. Go to these guys here, turn on the symmetry. Clear it, just smooth it out a little bit. Right? And now I can hit the BPR.
Right, because there's actually geometry now that you can assign a material to.
Yeah. Give it a second here to think.
And crash. Did you save it?
Nope.
Justin. Let me talk to you for a second. Uh-oh.
That's okay. Let's go back to this and see if it did it. Oh. Crash.
Wait for it. Let it think for a minute. It usually happens when you're doing a demo, too, right?
Oh yeah, always.
Wait for it. All right, guys, we need some good mojo in chat. Come on, guys.
Yeah.
Give us some everybody good mojo.
Pray. Everybody pray.
Where's a good mojo emocon? Where's the? Oh yeah, Meat Man. There we go. No, not salt or poop. Come on.
Let's close this.
Yeah.
Look at that.
Oh, all right. Hey, save it.
Yep.
Hashtag pray for Goby.
Pray. Pray, it works. Okay, so let's try a different version of KeyShot.
Okay, so I got another question. Yeah, everybody else save too. Got another question. In general, what makes a good character or environment design effective? That's a pretty large one. But as a judge for the ArtStation Challenge, what will you be looking for in people's designs? Any tips for getting better in 2D, 3D concept art? That's quite a large. Let's go with the middle one for now.
Yeah. That's many, many questions. So let's break it down into one part for me, and then I'll answer that one.
Okay, let's. I think we've been kind of already talking about the first and last one in there. So, more specifically, as a judge for the ArtStation Challenge, what will you be looking for in designs?
As a judge, I want to see, you know, some originality and that you're following the theme. I hope I get like a big range of all kinds of different styles and techniques. This one's not working either. That's what I'll be looking for, you know, as far as I go. And I'll be looking at how you lit your scene. I'll be looking at a lot of different things. So I guess, you know, I don't know any tips to, what was the second part question?
The other one is just more general, any tips to getting better at as a 2D or 3D concept artist.
For those, man, I mean, it's really going to be about all the tips and tricks that you can learn and pick up along the way. Which is why Gumroad and places like ArtStation and, any kind of online schooling is going to really help push you that in the right direction.
Right.
But I guess it's just like you got to choose your battles and figure out what do you want to do? You know what I mean? Like I ask that a lot of times, like when people come in here and they like, well, I want to intern. And they literally ask me like, oh, well, I don't know. Maybe there is, you know, is there anything you guys need? And I'm always hesitant to answer that because it's like, yes, there's always something that we're looking for, but I don't want to force someone to do that. You know what I mean? Like, that's not what I want to do in that regard.
Right, exactly. I mean, here's the answer, the blanket answer to if you want to be an intern. Learn how to take bagel orders. And coffee orders.
No.
I'm joking. But if you want to be an artist, figure out what you want to do as art, and then find work that way.
Yeah. Figure out what's your bag, you know? Because yeah. I'm not a mind reader. I'm not going to know what you're going to be more passionate about versus something that you're not.
Yeah.
You know? So...
You're looking for people to be... passionate about their art and their growth in the field, not necessarily a position filler.
Correct.
Right. So do you use a specific environment usually for KeyShot?
No, it all depends on what the overall feeling and the vibe is for the piece, really.
Right.
I try to keep it in a cinematic type setting.
Right.
And really take a look at those kinds of settings and figure out what I want to do in that regard. So now I'm just like kind of playing with some of these shapes here. Oh, here, I had this in the wrong window here. I'm not showing. There we go. So just figuring out, like, how I want those to light up. Do I want it as an emissive, or do I want it as a point light diffuse? Just kind of playing around.
So while you're doing that, I got another question. Any good books or videos for learning good design? Not workflow, but design.
Yes. Let me think about that one for a second here. I want to say... Oh, man. My books looks like somebody already raided my office for all my good books. There's a lot to choose from. And I know that, to be perfectly honest with you, I listen to a lot of The Collective, and I mm-hmm. really like what...
That's Ash Thorpe, right?
Yeah, that's Ash Thorpe stuff. Like, that's a cool... He's got a really, really cool sense on how he does certain things, as well as, like, the types of books that he researches. Usually, whenever he posts anything about a book to check out, like, I'm on easy mode, man. I don't really get a lot of chances to go out and look at stuff, so...
Right.
If somebody says it's good, I'm just gonna be like, yeah, sure. Let's try and I'll just buy that on Amazon.
I'm looking at my. Yeah, I know, right? I'll just get that. I'm looking at my bookshelf too, real quick. One of the ones that I suggest is the How to Render: The Fundamentals of Light and Shadow and Reflectivity by Scott Robertson.
Oh, that's a great book. Yes.
I don't know if you guys can see. That one, but this goes over a lot of awesome things. It's a little bit more like painting and drawing and stuff, but it goes over like all the fundamentals of what you should be looking at of like lighting and rendering, and it's huge, thick book, man. It's like, I don't know, just a shade under 300 pages. But that one's an amazing book that everybody should have on their shelf. And the other one too that I really like, I don't know if you have this one, Justin, but Framed Ink.
Ooh, Framed Ink is a good one. Yes.
Right. That, I forget who was that by. Is that by Miller?
No.
But it's a little bit more of like comic book, style, art, but it's all about, like framing and telling a story with your composition. That one's another really, really good one for like design and how to go about telling a story with you know, values and shapes and composition and stuff. That one's really, really good too.
Right now I'm just trying to paint out a different material.
Okay. Oh, so you're painting with...
Not actually changing or adding a sub tool or anything like that on top of this.
You're just painting with material, right?
Yeah, just painting with material, and hopefully it'll work. There we go, and we'll swap back into KeyShot. And now what I can do is, like, I can grab this and choose a different material.
Oh, that is sick.
Right?
Ah, yeah.
Or, like, say I want that to be a rubber... Or even just any color I want. Like, I now know that section can be whatever I choose it to be. And that's how I design with you know, using this kind of a workflow.
God, that's awesome, man. So do you have this type of idea in mind when you're sculpting from the beginning?
Kind of. Like, mentally, I'm making notes of some of the shapes that I've made or designed to, like, break that up and to be able to do different things with it when I go to this stage. And that's just because I know what I can do in this stage.
Right.
You know, like there's a rubber texture. You know, I could even go glass if I wanted to, you know, if I wanted to go with a, you know, a different kind of a look that way.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, there's some glass ones in here, and I do it all the time. I usually take, where is it, glass? Is it cubes? I love doing this one. I don't know why, but it looks so badass.
It reminds me of Cubert, dude.
Yeah, definitely. But then, yeah, I'll change with the texture and go in here with the bump and change the scale.
Yeah. Ah, oh, dude, that was awesome. Do they have a carbon fiber one in here?
They do. However, like, in their old versions, I feel like it was a much better material, and, I almost feel that it's still better to paint on carbon fiber.
Really? How do you paint, like, on carbon fiber?
Yeah, like, I'll paint the texture in there, or I'll do a matte in KeyShot where that's the color. And then I will essentially grab like a black glass and then put it over it, and that'll give me the shine that I want. Mm. But I mean, like, even though, like, you could see, like, it's weird, right? There's geometry on the inside of it that is making this this emissive light react inside. So I've done stuff where I've just put holes in there and just shove Greeble in, and then let whatever shines on the Greeble be what's inside the eye, you know?
Right. All kinds of fun, happy accidents then, huh?
Oh, yeah. Look at that.
Dude, what the? Wait a minute, what did you just do there? Is that...
So I just made this glass part here red.
What the? Wait, is that a specific... Is that glass basic red?
Yeah.
What the? Oh, my God. I need to do more stuff in KeyShot, man. I need to, like, get out of the... So my problem is that I usually spend way too much time farting around in ZBrush and sculpting. Mm-hmm. And then I hardly ever get to this point. Like, I need to...
Here's our carbon fiber texture. So it needs to be scaled, of course, but... Right, it just doesn't react as carbon fiber would, in my
opinion. Right. That's crazy, man. Yeah, this is looking awesome, dude. So on a scale of 1 to 10, how happy are you with this particular design at the moment?
And I think it's fun. I mean, there's a lot of places I could go with it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still pretty early.
So would you go at this point, let's say you hand it off to art director and the art director says, it's pretty cool, but this and this and this. Like, what would your next... If you went in and wanted to do some redesigns to it, like some heavy redesigns to it, like what would you be your process for doing that?
I'd do a lot of paint over. I would be like, okay, like if it all depends on the feedback that I'm getting. If the feedback that I'm getting isn't really what I'm looking for, then, you know, sometimes it's time to go back to the drawing board.
Right, you got to be able to, kill your darlings?
Yeah, you got to be able to let it go from time to time if it's not what you're wanting.
Right. My dogs are barking. Hey guys, it's okay. I know that there's another dog outside. You don't have to keep telling me over and over and over and over and over and over.
Oh, I know that. So well.
Right? Okay, there's a dog out there. Okay, got it. Okay, got it.
Congratulations. I know.
Yeah.
I
got yep. Okay. You definitely did your job. Okay, good job. Now I got it.
There's all kinds of different ways to do stuff.
Yeah. Whoa. Look like a jelly bean guy.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, that's really about it for my workflow. And then I'll do heavy paint on top of it.
That's awesome, man. It's really been very eye-opening to see your workflow and like how you do things. There's definitely some awesome, awesome stuff there. I think people may be mining this on the replay for a while.
good.
So if you guys get a chance, obviously definitely check out Ironclad Studios' website and all of the stuff that Justin has done. He's done some amazing, amazing work in the industry. Check out, if you're not working on the ArtStation Challenge, I encourage you to at least take a look at it and see all the fun stuff that's going on. You don't have to be a part of the ArtStation Challenge to follow people on there. I encourage anybody who is thinking about joining it to join it, even if you feel like you're not good enough to be in a challenge like this. It's not about if you're good enough. It's really about the journey, of, you know, going through this type of stuff with other artists. It's a great way to meet other artists and have, you know, just get yourself out there and learn along with everybody else. So, yeah, the journey.
That's what it's all about.
That's what it's all about. And that, my friends. So how do you feel? How are you feeling now? Are you pretty close to being done?
Yeah, I think so. I think I should probably give my arm a rest.
Yeah. But, well, let's not put you in the hospital. We want to we want more stuff from you, so we're going to go ahead and we'll wrap it up.
All right, sounds good, guys. Well, hey, thanks for having me on here, man. And hopefully I can come back on again.
Absolutely, man. I would definitely love to have you on. Super huge thanks for coming out and spending some time with us, man. I think we all kind of learned a lot from watching you do your thing, you know.
Well, good. I'm glad. It's been fun.
Yeah. Oh, so one last question is, a couple of people has asked this. Do you think, or do you have any insight on if there will be more challenges for the Art Station Challenge?
Oh, yes. I believe that this is one of many. And I don't believe I'm stepping on anybody's toes by saying that.
Okay, good. That's awesome to hear, because I think that we're all looking forward to more chances of joining the people that may not be able to join in at this one. So,
yeah.
Definitely. I think that you may, on the next round, though, you may need some more help for judging.
Yes.
Just plan that one from the beginning.
We really didn't think that was going to be that way.
Oh, man, that's awesome. So, awesome, man. Well, thank you very much again for coming out and for hanging out, man. It's been awesome. And we're going to go ahead and put this up on YouTube. So anybody who wants to go back, as long as that's okay with you, Justin. Is that all right with you?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Let's go ahead and I'll have my lawyer send over the paperwork for approval, and then I'll make sure that they'll talk with your people, and then we'll just do some beers while they do it.
Yeah, that sounds good.
Is that good? Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Awesome. So, hey, Justin, also, if you want to come by the next round, this is a good time to officially announce the next guest. What? J.J. Abrams. No, just kidding.
I'd be like, damn.
Brennan's moving up, dude.
Damn.
No, Kurt Papstein is going to be here next month.
Snap.
Mr. Kurt, the Papstein, the Steinerator.
That's going to be a good time for everybody involved.
Dude, it's going to be awesome.
Just not wearing pants.
Yeah, well, you know, a shirt is okay from, especially like, you know, do the news anchor view, you know, the
oh, yeah.
Right, pants unnecessary, but shirt definitely necessary, as long as it's from chest up, you know what I mean?
So exactly.
Yeah, definitely. So yeah, so Kurt Papstein will be here on, let me double check the date for you guys real quick. I hope this isn't awkward for you.
Oh, I'm fine,
bro. Dude, April 17th. Pretty much the same time. I think it's going to be either 2 or 3 o'clock, Pacific time. So either the same time as today or 1 hour later. But April 17th is going to be the next big one with Mr. the Papstein. So and Justin, you need to come by and hang out, dude. Maybe you should just by and hang out and like throw stuff up into chat, like really, really tough questions for him where like he has to think.
Ooh,
and
yeah.
Like, it's like awkward. You're like,
really awkward personal questions.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, I think we're onto something.
Maybe that'll be like a prerequisite for anybody who comes on and does my show, is that you have to come back for at least one, and then ask like super awkward questions.
I think that person. That's definitely a doable thing.
That'd be so awesome, dude. So it's going to be something similar to what Justin and I did. What Justin did today. It's not like I really did anything. But we're just going to be hanging out, talking about his experience and how he got into the field, and The work that he did on 10 Cloverfield Lane, the work that he did on Evolve, and kind of how he does stuff in ZBrush and all that kind of stuff. So it'll be similar to what Justin did here today. I don't think it'll be this badass though, because this is pretty badass.
Oh, we'll see. Don't say that. Kurt's pretty badass.
Yeah, I know, but he's got the bar set fairly high. So I'll make sure that he watches this video, just to see like, hey, look, this is the level of quality that we expect, Kurt. This is, you know, this is no joke broadcast, bro.
I love it. I am on board.
Awesome, man. All right, guys. Well, I think we're gonna wrap it up. So, Ed, do you have anything else, Justin?
No, that's it. Thanks for having me, and thanks for all the questions, guys.
Absolutely, man. All right, guys. Guys and gals, thank you again to my awesome super-duper moderator, Marcelo Labradora. Thank you very much, man, for being here and helping out. Maybe one of these times we'll actually get him on chat or on chatting with us one of these days. We'll see.
Yeah.
He actually exists. Just to let you guys know, Marcelo actually exists. He's a real person. He's not just a chat bot. Yeah. All right, guys. All right. We will see you guys very, very soon. I hope you guys, as I always say, I hope you had fun. I hope you learned some stuff. But most of all, I hope you were inspired. So go make some cool stuff. I want to see all the cool stuff. I want to see all the cool stuffs. All right, guys. Talk to you guys soon. See you later. Bye. Later.